So once again, good evening, brothers and sisters and fathers from different parts of the world. We are extremely happy that today we are able to have our usual Consecrated Life Lecture Series 6. For this meeting, for this lecture, we have very famous, renowned theologian, Father Jose Cristre from Spain. And a very hearty welcome to you, Father Cristre. It is always a pleasure to have you in our midst to listen to your wisdom and your experiences.
Thank you very much, dear Father Robin.
Yes. Then we also have fathers, sisters, brothers, superiors, provincial, superior generals from different parts of the world. And then some will be joining a little later, hope so. So in a very special way, in a very warmly and wholeheartedly, in the name of our institute, ICL, Institute of Consecrated Life, an unique institute in India which offers study and research on theology of consecrated life, I welcome all of you. And now I invite Sister Angela Gari from the Congregation of Clarice Franciscan Missionaries of Most Blessed Sacrament, one of our old students. She was with us for 9 months doing her diploma. And I invite her to introduce the speaker of the day. Welcome, Sister Angela.
Thank you, Father. A very good evening to you all. On this joyful, fascinating evening, I am immensely privileged to introduce to you all an eminent speaker for Consecrated Life Lecture Series 6. He is none other than Reverend Dr. Jose Cristre, CMF, a Clarician missionary, and a renowned theologian from Spain. Just a few words about him. He was born in Spain exactly on a Sunday of the Solemnity of Christ the King. So his parents named him Jose Cristre, which means Jose Christ the King. He completed his doctorate of theology in Rome in 1973. He taught in many universities and institutes of theology in Spain, Brazil, Colombia, Philippines, China, India, and so on. He is one of the best that we have today on missiology and theology of consecrated life. He has written many books and scholarly articles. Recently, Pope Francis appointed him as consultant of the Congregation for Institutes of Consecrated Life and Societies of Apostolic Life, Vatican, for a period of 5 years. Yes, brothers and sisters, we are indeed fortunate to have this exceptional and erudite personality with us this evening to inspire and to ignite us as consecrated persons on the theme, where there is consecrated person, there is joy and holiness. Dear Father Jose Cristre, behalf of all being tuned to their devices in different parts of India and abroad, I cordially welcome you to enrich and enlighten us. Welcome, dear distinguished professor.
Thank you very much, Sister Angela.
Good.
Thank you. So Father Cristre, over to you.
Yes. Thank you very much, Sister Angela, Sister Father Robin, for your invitation. I am glad of being with you and also sharing about this very, very important topic, the sanctity, holiness in consecrated life that Pope Francis has expressed in his exhortation as enjoy and exalt, exaltation and joy. Let us me share the screen so that we can better follow my reflection about this topic. We have here before us what will be the reflection of these two moments of sharing with you about the holiness in consecrated life. I have entitled my reflection in this way: where consecrated life is, there is holiness. Pope Francis said this in another way: where consecrated life is, there is joy. But not always there is joy where consecrated life is. But the main purpose of our vocation is that where consecrated life is, there is holiness. And strictly connected with holiness is joy and exaltation. Where consecrated life is, there is holiness. And the subtitle of this reflection would be Towards a Significant Concept of Holiness in Consecrated Life. Towards a Significant Concept, a Significant Concept of Holiness, but for our contemporaries in our time. And you see here that we have in the background the rainbow. The rainbow is the main symbol of the covenant. Our God is in covenant with his creation. This was the renewal of the covenant with Noah. After this very in certain moments of the history of humanity in which sin was overcoming everything, was the powerful force in creation in humanity. But our God has renewed his covenant with the whole earth, with the whole creation. And the rainbow is the symbol of this covenant. And the consecrated life has stressed in a very singular way this profession of covenant. Instead of calling of talking about perpetual vows, I prefer to talk about an ongoing covenant, a process of covenant with our God and God with us. Because covenant means, for one part, the one offering us his covenant, our God, our Trinitarian God. Another way, another side, we received this covenant with God, and we enter also in covenant with our God. Our reflection would have these steps. First of all, an introduction. Then we will have the perspective from which we look at the topic of the holiness, the perspective. Then we will also reflect about the inheritance of holiness we have received, our heritage of holiness in consecrated life, a huge cloud of holy men, holy women, followers today of Jesus, God's words and Eucharist as the main expression of holiness. In covenant of love, we are in covenant of love, in mission, in community, and in a process of transformation. And then the conclusions. So you will see that our reflection has different steps, perspectives, inheritance, to be followers, contemporary followers of Jesus in our time, holiness, contemporary holiness, in covenant of love, in mission, in community, and in a process of ongoing transformation. And finally, the conclusions. I hope that you are able to follow well my reflection, my voice, and also the topics that I am explaining. If you like, also, you have any questions that you have, please, you can write in the chat. Let us start with introduction. holiness in consecrated life. According to the canon law, there is an expression that it is very important in the laws of the church for ourselves as consecrated life. Those who profess the evangelical counsels belong to the life and to the holiness of the church, and must be fostered and promoted by all in the church. So we who profess the evangelical counsels, we belong to that area of the whole church in which there is life and holiness. We belong to the life of the church. We are their motors of life, but at the same time, we are there as motors, dynamics of holiness for the whole church. And this life and holiness has to be forced, fostered, and promoted by all of us. So canon law, in this canon 574, number one, there focus the experience of profession of evangelical counsels in the perspective of holiness and life. But the horizon of holiness have been blurring among us. Why? Because many of us talk in our times less of holiness and more of other perspective in our way of life. For instance, we do not talk very much about holiness, but certainly about the option for the poorest, for the lowly, for those who are discarded from our society. Instead of the horizon of holiness, we talk more about our mission or about our peripheries in which we try to be there. So the horizon of holiness, of sanctity among us, has been blurring among us. And in many times in our centers of formation, in ongoing formation, we do not call our brothers and sisters to be holy, but more to be in commitment, committed with mission, committed with community, committed with spirituality, but not so much with holiness. In some institutes, religious hardly speaks of sanctity or holiness. It has become an obsolete language. We talk certainly about holiness, holy men and women, when we try to make that our founders would be canonized or beatified by the church. And in that moment, we talk about holiness, but not so much regarding ourselves. It has become an obsolete language. This is the reason why Pope Francis has discovered the need of talking about or reflecting about holiness and sanctity, but perhaps in another horizon that of tradition. Nowadays, we need new perspectives, a new language, new experiences. When you call someone to come into religious life, you do not ask him, do you like to be a holy man, a holy woman? Do you come here to our community in order to search for sanctity or for holiness? Perhaps the questions that we put to our new candidates are not this, are another ones. Would you like to be committed in the cause of the kingdom of God? Would you like to fight against the evildoers, against poverty, against oppression, abuses, and so on? This is okay, but not the perspective of holiness. But because of that, we need new perspectives, new language, new experiences. Let me continue. Pope Francis has written this apostolic exhortation, very, very important and very challenging. Apostolic exhortation, Gaudete et Exultate, on the call to holiness in today's world. It is important, this subtitle, the call to holiness in today's world. So we have now another sensitivity, but please pay attention to this title, Gaudete et Exultate. Gaudete is enjoy. So the perspective of holiness is joy, rejoice. Gaudete, rejoice, is the perspective of joy. And secondly, the perspective of exultate, exalt, means like to be people in exaltation, people full of vitality. Gaudete et exultate. The call to holiness in today's world is presented by our Pope in another perspective that I will develop during this reflection, but applied to our way of life, consecrated life. Pope Francis' goal in his apostolic exhortation is to repropose the call to holiness in a practical way for our own time, with all its risks, challenges, and opportunities. In number two of Gaudete et Exultate, Gaudete Exultate number two, the Pope presented to us a new way of understanding holiness in our time. Risks, challenges, and opportunities. At times, we do not think that we are holy, but perhaps in some moments of our life, we reach high levels of holiness. But we talk about that with other words, with other concepts, from other perspectives. But you see that the call of to holiness in today's world of Pope Francis is a call also to be joyful, to be people with rejoicing life, to be people who are glad and are able to convoke others to this joy of the gospel. This is true that one of the main topics of our Pope is always rejoice, gaudete, Evangelii Gaudium, the joy of the gospel, of the evangelizing. Veritatis Gaudium, the joys of the truth. Amoris Laetitia, the joyful or the joy of love, and so on. So our Pope is always presenting all the topics from the perspective of joy. To be a holy man, a holy woman, is to be a joyful man, a woman who enjoys. The whole index, the whole content, the content of the whole exhortation could be expressed in three parts. The first part is the call to holiness excludes no one. That means that the vocation to be holy is a universal vocation. From the great saints of old to the saints of our times. And anyone in the church who is baptized is excluded from the call to holiness. Our calling is not only our calling to form a congregation, to share a consecrated life, but as Christians is the call to holiness. All of us have received this calling and we have to answer to it. Second, holiness today faces threats, risks, from some enemies. Who are the enemies of holiness today? And perhaps we have not reflected too much about this, but this could be also be very present in consecrated life. Gnosticism is one of the enemies of holiness. Gnosticism means, we will see after, but Gnosticism means those who think that theology is enough to be a holy man or holy woman. To know a lot of things about theology, knowledge, sacred knowledge, or knowledge about humanity, knowledge is enough to be holy. Pelagianism is another risk, another danger. And this danger means that if we do things in the right way, with success, we are holy. And then, I do not know many things, but what I am doing is the best that I can do. And that this is holiness, that we are beatified, we are holy because of that what we do. And finally, ideologies. If you are an ideologist of right or other ideologies that are more progressive, this is what makes you a holy man, a holy woman. So these are the three risks that the Pope outlines against sanctity in our times. And finally, holiness is identified with, so the Christian vision of holiness in our time for the Pope is this, the Beatitudes. The seven Beatitudes of the Sermon on the Mountain are the traits, the main traits of holiness. Five virtues that the Pope presents two by two: patience and meekness, happiness and sense of humor, audacity and fervor, community life, and prayer. The five virtues of holiness: patience, meekness, happiness, sense of humor, audacity and fervor, in community and prayer. And three dynamics: the spiritual struggle, vigilance, and discernment. So this is the whole vision of Gaudete et Exultate, of the apostolic exhortation of Pope on sanctity, on holiness. Now, let us apply all this to our way of life in consecrated life. The purpose of these two conferences is, if consecrated life belongs to the holiness of the Church, where does the Holy Spirit is leading us today? What are the paths towards holiness in consecrated life today? What are the new ways towards holiness that the Holy Spirit offers us in our contemporary time? Because to be holy in 21st century is not the same as to be holy in 20th century. We are in another times. We are in the third decade of this 21st century. For that, how to be holy today, not yesterday? The seven steps will be what we have seen before, but I repeat now: the perspective, the inheritance, followership, covenant, mission, eco-community, and transformation. The perspective of holiness today, the inheritance we have received, how to be followers of Jesus today, followers of a contemporary Jesus, the following Jesus in covenant, the covenant, our religious profession, perpetual vows, we call this covenant, mission as a source of holiness, eco-community, also a source of holiness, and finally, processes of transformation. So let us now enter into the perspective. The perspective of holiness. A holy man, a holy woman, is one who is separated from others, or is one who is included, incarnated with others. What is the meaning of holiness? And we try here to have a reflection about a Hebrew word, kadosh. Holiness in Hebrew is kadosh. The root meaning of holiness in Hebrew is kodesh, kadosh. And the meaning of kadosh is to be separated. We can say that in our liturgy, we use instruments that are separated from others. We use the chalice not for everything, but only for a sacred use. That means that the chalice is separated from other instruments that we have. The altar is not a table. The altar is only separated from other tables. And so the root meaning of holiness is something what is separated, and is separated because we dedicate it to the cult, to the liturgy, to the our connection with our God. And for that also, the priests in the Old Testament were kadosh. They were separated from the common, the normal way of life. Kadosh, for that, means something separated. When our Mother Mary said, because the name of God is holy, his name is holy, means that the name of God is not similar to any one of the names here on the earth. The name of God is unknown. The name of God is holy, is kadosh, is totally separated from our own perspectives. So this is the meaning of holiness in Hebrew. God is separated from us and from his created world. I am God, I am not human. He said in the prophet Hosea, in chapter 11, I am God, I am not human, I am separated, I am different of you, I am not a thing, I am not a man, a woman, I am not some thing inhabiting in your world, I am God, I am not human. This is what we call the transcendence of God. God is transcending us in all, and the word of God is totally separated from the word of our own created and profane world. At times, consecrated life thought that sanctity means to be outside, to be separated from others. And at times our convent, our monasteries, try to be totally separated as holy house, as holy convent, as holy monastery. And there is the place, are places in which the other ones cannot enter, because these places are reserved for holiness. And we have also in the habits, in the ways of living, this separation. And when someone enters into a monastery, is separated from the secular world. And when someone enters into a convent, a sister is separated from other ones. And when some of them live consecrated life, religious life, we say that they are secularized. And we think that our religious house is sacred, is religious, but that our home with our parents, father, mother, brothers, this is not a sacred place. So in this vision, sanctity, holiness, means to be separated. And at times in some congregations, the constitution say, why you have come to this congregation. The main purpose of your coming to this congregation is because you like to be holy. And you will find here the ambience, the context in which you will be on the line of holiness, of being always more holy. And when some person becomes more holy, is more separated from the profane world. This is one part of the biblical perspective, especially in the Old Testament. But there exists another perspective in the Bible. The Holy Spirit fills the earth. After the resurrection of Jesus, the Holy Spirit was sent. And the Holy Spirit was sent to everyone. The Holy Spirit was sent to the earth. The day of Pentecost is not only one day in the whole calendar of the world. The day of Pentecost, as Origen said, every day is Pentecost. Every day the Holy Spirit is in the midst of us. The Holy Spirit fills the earth. The Holy Spirit is always fighting against the evil spirits so that the earth becomes the kingdom of God. The Holy Spirit sent by God the Father and by the risen Lord. When it is convenient for you, Jesus said that I go away, and Jesus in heaven and the Father, they have sent to us the Holy Spirit. We are in the times of the mission of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit, where she is present or he is present, consecrates, tries to consecrate everything to lead humanity and creation to the fulfillment. So, can we say also now that the Holy Spirit, where he or she is present, there is sanctity? Holy Spirit was called by the fathers of the church Panagion. Pan is totally agion, holy. Panagion is el completely holy, the Holy Spirit. But also Mary, our mother, was called Panagia. Pan, holy, totally, Agia, totally holy. Mary was also the totally holy, but the presence of Mary, the presence of the Holy Spirit, is now everywhere. So we cannot say the Holy Spirit is always, in prison in a church, or only in prison in a holy man, a holy woman. No, the Holy Spirit fills the earth. And this means that everything can become holy if it is in the contact with the Holy Spirit. After the resurrection, Lord Jesus, our risen Lord, includes in his heart the whole creation. Is the cosmic Jesus. Is the Jesus of the whole humanity. Is the Jesus that has given his love for the salvation of the whole world, not only of some part of the world. Jesus is the real savior of the whole creation, of the whole humanity. Jesus is the Jesus of inclusions. When we look at Jesus in his life, in the short time in which Jesus was with us, in this short time, especially in the three last years of his life, Jesus was the Jesus of inclusions, not of exclusions. Jesus was gathering crowds. Jesus was healing all the sick. Jesus was giving life to all people in the fields of death. The dream of Jesus was the kingdom of God everywhere, in all the times. The dream of Jesus was the kingdom of God transforming the whole reality. the dream of Jesus was to recover the main project, the first project of creation. At the very beginning was not so. And Jesus for that has given his life. Jesus was the Jesus of inclusions, not of exclusions. Jesus wanted to create a whole community. Was the good shepherd trying to gather all the sheep, even the lost sheep. He was able to abandon the 99 sheep in order to find the one who was lost. Jesus of inclusions, including one other people of the whole world. And at the end, when Jesus has appeared to his disciples in the Mount of Galilee, what said to them? Go to all the nations, to all the whole world, to preach the gospel. The main purpose of Jesus was to make holy the whole humanity, all the nations, all the cultures, all the languages. And so, in our times, also, Pope Francis tries to be the Pope of inclusions, inclusiveness, not the Pope of exclusions. And so we can enter into the field or into the space of the Holy Spirit with very different actions, as Mother Teresa with the poorest, as our Pope with all the representative of religious women in the world, so that they could not be find themselves excluded. I have to remember that in this meeting, this was the president of the religious sisters in that time, in that encounter with the Pope, was the moment in which the religious sisters has asked the Pope to think about the diaconate of the sisters, of the women within the church. And also, we have here our great founders and foundresses, those who have started their own way of sanctity, of holiness, but especially looking at the people in need, looking at humanity, not by exclusion, but by inclusion, including all of us at the service of the whole humanity in different ways. And finally, we have also a community, normal community today, a community of inclusion, a community who tries to give the joy of the gospel to everyone. This is the perspective. Let us now talk about our inheritance. Inheritance, a huge cloud of saints in consecrated life. So, this is true, our heritage in all the congregations. If we look at our ancestors, at those who have preceded us in our own vocation, what we find immediately is that we are in a congregation, a community of holy men and holy women. And we can also tell stories of holiness. I think that at times we are in this sense a little modest, and we are shy, and we reflect more about ideas than about examples, stories. What is better? To talk very much about the ideal of holiness, or to present to our brothers and sisters, to tell them stories of holiness. Stories of holiness we have a lot, and we can tell a lot of stories of holiness. But let us look simply at the whole vision of the consecrated life. We belong to a wonderful community of saints, consecrated virgins of the first centuries. St. Ambrose, the Bishop of Milan, was the one explaining in a very beautiful book, stories, telling us stories of consecrated virgins in his time. It is said that when he was talking and preaching about consecrated life, the virginity, a lot of young women wanted to follow this path of holiness. The fathers of the monks, San Antonia, the abbot, Pacomius, there are also stories of holiness, beautiful stories of holiness, the holiness in the deserts. They were creating like a new culture. They abandoned the cities and they went to the desert. And it is said that in that time, cities were depopulated, but the deserts became populated because they wanted to create a new culture for the whole humanity in the deserts. Also the most relevant founders, San Francis, Clara of Assisi, Dominic, Ignatius, Teresa of Jesus, Mary Ward, all of them were holy men, holy women, opening our eyes to new perspective of holiness, a perspective of holiness in very different fields, because they wanted to embrace different groups of human people in order to offer to them the best of sanctity. Then countless religious martyrs all over the world and in all the times. It is said that also in our times, we have a lot of martyrs. The example, the stories of our martyrs is wonderful. And when we look at them, we see that they have not enemies. They have converted their own enemies in their own prayers, in their own desires of transformation. And our religious sisters and brothers today, who even without being canonized, have been and are really holy. The Pope says in a very graphical way that if we are in a convent and we have different rooms, in the next room, the door of the next room is the door of the holy man, of a holy woman. The sanctity of the next door. That means that at times we do not appreciate very much in the context in which we are living. But near of us, with us, there are holy men, holy women, and also a context, a tradition of holiness that we cannot forget. Where consecrated life is, there is holiness. Mary Ward, St. Francis, Ignatius, Dominic, St. Vincent of Paul, Clara and Francis. In present times, near of us, there is the holiness of the next door. Those brothers or sisters living with us in the next room of our monastery, of our convent or religious house, in them is frequently reflected the presence of God. So this is a wonderful opening of this beautiful, also beautiful apostolic exhortation of Pope Francis about sanctity for all of us. So, let us now have a time for your reflection or your questions. Then we will continue to look at consecrated life from different perspectives, following Jesus, covenant of love, mission, community, and process of transformation. But now we can also reflect a little more about what I said and what I have presented to you regarding this topic. Followers today, is the third point in which we are. Followers of Jesus today, God's Word and Eucharist. It is interesting that we have some moments of connection with Jesus, connection with we listen the gospel and the word of Jesus comes to us through the power of the Holy Spirit. And also the moments in which we receive the body and the blood of Jesus. So we are followers of Jesus, but at the same time, within the church, in our communities, we have contact with Jesus through the word and through the Eucharist. We are followers of Jesus in this time, contemporary Jesus, present in the word on the Eucharist, what is holiness? So let us first of all reflect about the last question that some of you have presented to us. A contemporary Jesus. We are not followers of Jesus, of the Jesus of the past, of Jesus of Galilee, of Jesus of the first century. We need to contemplate Jesus in a contemporary way. As you said before, the great Protestant theologian Calvart has presented Jesus in his church dogmatic as our contemporary. He has written a lot of books about the dogmatic of the church and has presented in very different volumes his vision of creation, of redemption, of reconciliation, of spiritual presence, the presence of the Spirit. He said, nevertheless, that Calvart, if he could also write his theology at the very beginning, writing again his church dogmatic at the end of his life, he would start with the last volume. The last volume was to think in all through the presence of the Holy Spirit. You know that at the end of his life in the synagogue, Jesus said, "The Holy Spirit will be sent to you, and the Holy Spirit will guide you to the complete truth. The Holy Spirit will talk to you about me." So the Holy Spirit is the one that in every moment of history is making Jesus contemporary of that people. In the third century, a Jesus contemporary of the people of the third century. In the 16th century, the Holy Spirit was offering them a contemporary Jesus. But in our 21st century, the Holy Spirit is also offering us a contemporary Jesus. You know, perhaps you have watched different movies about Jesus. If you look at a movie of the last century, you see an image of Jesus that perhaps for us today is not too touching, is not too moving and inspiring us like the contemporary images of Jesus. Now there is a representation of Jesus in a movie that is like a series, is The Chosen. And in that movie, The Chosen, Jesus appears in a contemporary context, even though being the Jesus of his time, but Jesus has to say something to the contemporary people. So that means that the Holy Spirit is the one updating Jesus in each generation, in each country, in each culture, in each time, in different times. The great Protestant Calvart was right when we thought that we have to follow a contemporary Jesus. Jesus does not belong to the past. The Holy Spirit makes Jesus present in our times and spaces. And you have also the duty and at the same time the possibility of presenting a contemporary Jesus. At times we make archaeology archaeologic Christology. That means that we express very well what was happening in the times of Jesus and what it was the meaning of the words of Jesus in that time. But we have to recover today the memory of Jesus in order to talk about the presence of Jesus today. Jesus is present today. Jesus is talking to our societies, to our different cultures, and Jesus has to be updated. And the one making Jesus present in our times is always the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will guide you. I cannot say to you everything. The Holy Spirit will remember you, inspire you, so that I could be present in every age. And we see that followers of Jesus we have also today. Today are people who are attracted very much, seduced by Jesus, by his gospel, by his presence. But we make Jesus contemporary. And through us, through our faces, Jesus appears with a new face and with a contemporary face to others. This is the main purpose of the church. The church is like the contemporary face of Jesus, the body of Jesus, but in our time. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. I am going away, and I am coming to you. If you love me, you would rejoice that I am going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. But see, I am going away and I am coming to you. This is also the promise of a contemporary Jesus. I am going away, I am coming to you. But the advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything. So what Jesus was not able to teach us, the Holy Spirit will teach us everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. So when we listen to the gospel, the Holy Spirit is reminding us of the words of Jesus. And through the evangelist, the Holy Spirit has tried so that everybody could in the future listen the same words of Jesus, what Jesus has said to us. The Holy Spirit will testify on my behalf. He will guide you. He will glorify me. And we could add, he will make me a contemporary of all the ages. And so when we try today to write a Christology, we have to write a Christology, a contemporary Christology, listening to the voice of the Holy Spirit, what the Holy Spirit is saying to us about Jesus in our times, and not only to make archaeological Christology, what Jesus of Nazareth has done in the first century. This could be interesting, but the Holy Spirit also is a Christologist. The Christology of the Holy Spirit is more interesting than only an archaeological Christology, because Jesus has promised us that the Holy Spirit will glorify Jesus. The Holy Spirit will testify on behalf of Jesus, will guide us to Jesus. This is, in my opinion, these are the limits of some Christologies, that they are too much attached to the past, but they are not pneumatological Christologies. The pneumatological Christologies are different. They are saying to us how Jesus is present today in the midst of us. To follow Jesus in this time and to be identified with a contemporary Jesus, that is holiness. So we have a first conclusion. To follow Jesus in this time and to be identified with contemporary Jesus, that is holiness. Before I talk, I have mentioned a monk, Thomas Merton. I have mentioned also a woman, Mother Teresa, Holy Mother Teresa of Calcutta. So these two, this man and this woman, made Jesus contemporary. But also we could also say that Gandhi has made Jesus contemporary. The preaching of Gandhi about peace, about reconciliation, about non-violence. This is a Jesus, a contemporary Jesus. Through the Holy Spirit has chosen him in order to be the evangelist of the non-violence. And Martin Luther King, I have a dream. I have a dream. The dream of the reconciliation of the races. And that dream was the dream of Jesus present in Martin Luther King in this time. And so we have like the new incarnations of Jesus, of the contemporary Jesus. That is holiness. Now let us talk about the presence of Jesus in the Word and the Eucharist. Our main rule is the Gospel. We listen to the voices of the Bible with the interior voice of the Spirit, more emotional than intellectual. Within the context we are living, we are consecrated by the Word. So, when we listen to the Word of God, the Lectio Divina is a moment that you know very well of contact with Jesus. Here, I have presented to you a picture of Jesus on the cross. But as you see, the expression of this Jesus is a laughing Jesus. How Jesus can laugh, be laughing on the cross? This cross is the cross of the sanctuary of St. Francis Xavier in the city of Javier, there in Spain, where St. Francis Xavier was born. And the image of Jesus is the image of a laughing Jesus. Jesus, after his work, redemptive work, Jesus was laughing and full of joy because he has reached the end of his mission. Father, in your hands I put my mission. And the mission of Jesus came also until now to us. But that Jesus also requires of us that we also be the laughing, full of humor Christians, missionaries of Jesus in our time. Consecrated by the Eucharist of the body and blood, the presence of the Jesus, of the risen Lord Jesus today. Our Lord Jesus is present every day in his own communities. This presence, Eucharistic presence, is something that we have to admire, to worship, to adore. This presence of the Lord Jesus is, I will be with you all the days, until the end of the times. And we receive the visit of Jesus everywhere, every day. The visit of Jesus through the words, the proclamation of the Bible, of the Holy Scriptures, the proclamation of the Gospel, and also by receiving the holy bread of the body and life of Jesus. Consecration is the consecration of the gifts, consecration of the community within the dynamic context of the liturgical year as the cornerstone at the center of our life and mission. So the liturgical year makes contemporary Jesus in all the days of the year. Now we are making Jesus contemporary in Advent, in our hopes, in our dreams. And then we will make Jesus present in the birth of new things, new society, Then during the whole year, we celebrate the presence of Jesus in very different moments and ways of our life. That is the contemporary Jesus. In the liturgy, in the liturgical year, we find a contemporary Jesus. But everything happens by the imagination, creativity of the Holy Spirit. Our charisms are also the face of a contemporary Jesus. The different charisms in the church, not only consecrated life, but also the charisms of the movements, the charisms of the particular churches, the charisms of the local churches and domestic churches, families, are faces of a contemporary Jesus. We are called to be living and existential icons of Jesus, of a contemporary Jesus. An obsolete memory of Jesus is irrelevant. We represent that kind of virtues of Jesus that are more meaningful for the people of our time and cultures. If you are an icon of Jesus, an image of Jesus, you are a holy man, a holy woman. You are representing Jesus in very different ways through the races that are in the world. All the races are images of Jesus, icons of God. Listening to the word of God, participate at the Eucharist. Charismatic performance of a contemporary and contextualized Jesus, inspired and moved by Jesus, by the Spirit of Jesus, that is holiness. Holiness is to make present Jesus in our times in a contemporary way, because a holy who is representing Jesus in the past is like a manuscript, at least like something in the past remembering us of Jesus. But holiness means to be representative of a contemporary Jesus. Then in covenant of love, in mission, in community. In covenant of love forever against idols. I would like now to focus more in consecrated life. We talk many, many times about the final vows, perpetual vows. It's that moment in which we profess to be always, forever, at the service of our Lord. And we present to him our final vows, vows forever. But perhaps instead of talking only about vows, it's better to talk about this covenant of love between God and ourselves. Not only I promise to God to be always with him and to answer always to my vocation, but also God is in covenant with me, and God promised me to be with me forever. Forever and forever. This covenant is dual, is not only unilateral. It's not I say to my God, I would like to accomplish my promises forever. But also God said to me too, I would be with you forever. It's covenant. Covenant is circular. It's not only a movement unilateral. It's a plurilateral. From me to God, from God to me. And what is what we promise? To be against the idols. We promise that our God will be the only God, not only idols. And you know what are the idols of our times. The idol of our times could be called sex, is for many people his or their idol. For others is power. They are looking always for power. Power is their God. And other ones, richness, money. There are people who only are totally devoted to money, others to powers, others to sex. but we promise that our only God is our wholeness, and we promise him to be against the idol of power with obedience, against the God of money with poverty, against the God of sex with celibacy. Prophetic way of being before our God in order to present the covenant, but a covenant against idol. Or we express in the New Testament to love God with all our heart, with all our soul, and with all our strength, and to love our neighbor as oneself. That is much more important than all the burnt offerings and sacrifices. So Jesus has presented to us also a way of living this in a prophetical way. In our consecrated life, we love God with all our heart, celibacy, with all our soul, community life and obedience, and with all our strength, poverty, with all our riches. And to love one's neighbor as oneself. But you remember that in the first Christian community, it is said also that the Christian community of Jerusalem has one heart, one soul, and all the goods in common, all the riches in common. So this was the dream of the Christian community, one heart, one soul, and all in common. This was the way of loving God and loving at the same time brothers and sisters. This is the dream that consecrated life, the religious life, tries to perform and to accomplish, to achieve. One heart, one soul, all our goods in common, and to love neighbor as ourselves. The Holy Spirit leads us to a new kind of relationship with power, money, and sex. We cannot say that power is something evil, or money is evil, or sex is evil. No, we do not demonize power, money, and sex. We know that power is something important in life, and we try also not to be powerless, but to use in the right way our power, to also use money in the right way, and also to perform our sexual life in the right way according to our vocation. We do that in a prophetic way, a symbol for the whole humanity, at times so attracted by power, too much attracted by money and sex. We say power is not God, money is not God, sex is not God. For that, we are like advices, like signs of alarm regarding the idolatry. And because of that, we exaggerate a little our relation with power, with money, and with sex. They very easily become our idols, and we are advertising them, please, please, power, money, and sex could become idols. Even though power, money, and sex have a luminous perspective, they are lights in our life, important lights, but when this light becomes an idol, then we are lost. And this is the main purpose of our way of life, prophetic way of life. We are not against, we are in favor, but in the whole context of the covenant with our God. Nevertheless, sex, money, and power have two faces, the luminous and beautiful, the dark and the diabolic, and we are against this part. And for that, we exaggerate a little prophetically the topic of power, money, and sex. Regarding power, whoever wishes to be great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be your slave. Just as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as ransom for many. This is what the Holy Spirit counsels us. This is the evangelical counsel that we try to do. Regarding sex, how to master our sexuality, to keep our bodies as living sacrament of the covenant of love, to avoid all kinds of sexual violence, abuses against children, against our sisters and brothers, to honor the human body and its sexuality as sacred, as a divine mystery. This is the evangelical counsel, the counsel of the Holy Spirit regarding sex. And finally, the Holy Spirit is our counselor regarding money. Greed is idolatry, said the letter of Paul to the Ephesians. To believe in the providence of God, God will provide, don't worry. To share the condition of the poor, to be near of the poorest of the world. And also poverty is generosity without the limits. There are people who have nothing because they are too much generous. They are always giving what they receive in benefit of others. And to be like the poor Jesus. You see that I have started all these evangelical counsels with the Holy Spirit as our counselor. The Holy Spirit, our counselor regarding power. The Holy Spirit, our counselor regarding sex. The Holy Spirit, our counselor regarding money. So you see that at times we need a counseling. We have to receive a counseling from outside in order to create in ourselves a great personality. The Holy Spirit has to be our counselor. And our counselor is presenting to us the way of overcoming all these difficulties. The misery of prosperity, who places his security in wealth, fall apart when it fails, is rich in his heart. And by not leaving space for God, for the brothers and sisters, a rich man becomes incapable of enjoying the most beautiful and important things in life. To be faithful to our covenant of love with God, in obedience, chastity and poverty, guided and empowered by the Holy Spirit, this is holiness. So, that is holiness, to live, to be faithful to our covenant of love with God, in obedience, chastity, and poverty, guided and empowered, counseled by the Holy Spirit, that is holiness. We continue our reflection now from another perspective, in mission. What is holiness in mission? Accomplices of the Spirit. Sharing the mission day. We are not missionaries in the first line. We are participants of a mission that comes to us from outside. There is no participation in Christ without participation in his mission to the world. So Jesus wanted to make us participants in his mission, the mission day, all participants in the mission of the Holy Spirit. So a mission is not only to perform a lot of works. At times some religious, they say, I am working in a parish, I am working in a school, I am working with a community of poor people, I am working in a hospital. No, you are not working. You are not a worker. You are not an employer. You are a collaborator of God in his mission. The Holy Spirit is in mission in a parish. The Holy Spirit is in mission in a school. The Holy Spirit is in mission in a hospital. The Holy Spirit is in mission with the poorest and with the outcasts. The Holy Spirit is in mission everywhere, but the Holy Spirit also has chosen people to collaborate with the Holy Spirit. We are not the main protagonist. We are secondary actors and actresses in mission. And for that, what we have to do is to be always attentive to the movement of the Holy Spirit in mission and to collaborate with the Holy Spirit. But we do not do that because this is our work. This is our way of getting a salary. No, we are sharing the mission of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has to be moving us. But imagine that the Holy Spirit wanted to have a parish in this way, and I try to create a parish in my own way. The Holy Spirit would like a professor, a teacher, teaching in his way, and I try to impose that my own way. So we are accomplices of the Spirit. We have to enter into the movement of the Spirit, never outside, because outside of the Spirit, that is not Missio Dei, that is Missio Diaboli, is Missio of the demons, of the evil spirits. Mission today is the network of the Holy Spirit that is weaving together across our planet. Within this network, a very special place is held by the community that Jesus called his spouse, the Church. But inside the Church, the communities of consecrated life. We are in the network, in the ecosystem of the mission of the Spirit. And we have to be always like mystics of the presence of the Holy Spirit through us, in us. So what the Holy Spirit would like to do through me, in myself. We are partners of the Holy Spirit in mission, enhancing the prophetic wing of the Church. We are partners of the Holy Spirit with a prophetic mission. Prophetic means exaggerated in a certain way. Prophetic means someone who is totally devoted to offer the others what is the will of God. Prophetic wing of the Church, where the prophetic spirit is blowing geographical and existential peripheries. So in the peripheries, we do not search for money. In the peripheries, we do not search for recognition. In the peripheries, we do not search for be more powerful than others. In the peripheries, we are partners of the Spirit with our own charisms, knowing that the Holy Spirit is from there also saving and reconciliating the world. The Church, the humanity, needs our prophecy. And my brothers and sisters, we are prophets, and we have to be continuing the prophecy of the old prophets, of the New Testament prophets, of the Church prophets. To become partners of the Spirit in our own charismatic and prophetic ministry, especially in the peripheries, existential and geographical peripheries, to become partners of the Spirit in our charismatic and prophetic ministry, especially in the peripheries, that is holiness. So you have seen how we are approaching to the topic of holiness from different perspectives. To be, that is holiness. And in community.
Father, we have already 7:30. Now the program is only till 7:30.
Then I will conclude. Conclusions.
Yes,
Six conclusions coming from this perspective. The first, to follow Jesus in this time and to be identified with a contemporary Jesus, that is holiness. Second, listening to the word of God, participate at the Eucharistic table, charismatic performance of a contemporary and contextualized Jesus, inspired and moved by the Spirit, that is holiness. Third, to be faithful to our covenant of love with God in obedience, chastity, and poverty, guided and empowered by the Holy Spirit. That is holiness. What we said just now, to become partners of the Spirit with our own charismatic and prophetic ministry, especially in the peripheries, that is holiness. And community leads us to pay attention to the details of our daily life, which show mutual care. In the midst of these small details, we are given consoling experiences of God. That is holiness. In community life, in the midst of these small details, we are given consoling experiences of God. That is holiness. The next door, the holiness of the next door. And finally, the dialogue of permanent life with the Spirit of the Father and of Jesus that generates in us an almost imperceptible transformation and introduces us in the way of love, that is holiness. We never are holy, completely holy. We are always in processes of holiness. You remember the companion of Jesus near of the cross. Lord, I would like to be with you. You will be with me today in the paradise. So, my sisters and brothers, this is the perspective that I try to offer to all of you in this reflection, and also to encourage you to read more and more the apostolic exhortation of Pope Francis and to apply it to our way of life, of daily way of life, missionary life, prophetic life.
Good evening to one and all. Here I am to express a heartfelt thanks to everyone, very especially to Reverend Father Jose Cristo Rey, the resource person of this evening, for having embraced and enlightened us. Father, our heart is full of gratitude to you for imparting us your experiences and wisdom. Thank you, Father, for sharing your wide experience, knowledge, and inspiring us to remain holy always as consecrated persons. Where there are consecrated persons, there is joy and holiness. My sincere thanks to Father Arul Jesu Robin, the director, and all the staff members of ICL, Institute of Consecrated Life, Sannyasa, for organizing this wonderful program. A deep sense of appreciation and gratitude to all the participants for your active involvement throughout the session. I place on record our immense gratitude to all the major superiors who participated and encouraged their members to avail this excellent opportunity of ongoing formation. We especially thank all those who have participated from different parts of the world. Thanking you all once again for your wholehearted cooperation, I remain wishing you all the very best for your journey as consecrated persons. Once again, thank you.